What's up, everyone? I'm Roxanne Avalon, and welcome to another episode of Music Rocks. We're coming to you live right now from Music Studios Los Angeles, and we have a really exciting show today. I'm here with my very special guest, Marq Torien from BULLETBOYS. What's up, Marq?
What's happening,
I'm so
Roxanne?
Excited to have you on today.
Thank you so much for having us.
You look so cool.
Oh, thank you
so much. You know what? I brought my shades because he looks so cool, and I wanted to look cool, too. And then everyone's like, no, Roxanne, just take them off. So, all right. All right.
No, you're fabulous, Roxanne.
So, yeah, you know, it's really cool because BULLETBOYS, I mean, such a legendary name. You guys have been going for a long stretch. You've come from back then to now and into the future. So tell me about what you got going on.
Well, what do you want to know about?
Oh, man. Well, okay, well, the first thing I want to know about, because we can't talk about BULLETBOYS without talking about Smooth Up In Ya.
There we go.
I want to get the first thing out of the way because I am a big BULLETBOYS fan and I love that song.
Thanks, Roxanne.
But I've wondered to myself, how does one smooth up in ya? And what is that? Tell me, I gotta know.
Would you like to hear the real story?
I want to hear the real, because this is straight, you know, from the source, and you know, there might be a lot of rumors, but I've always wondered, and I'm sure all of you guys who have ever heard that song. I mean, if we have a clip, so we're gonna play a clip for a second, and then we want to hear the story behind it.
Okay.
All right. So let's check out the clip because it's an awesome music video.
It's a really rad story too.
I can't wait to hear it.
People are gonna go like, what?
What?
No, totally.
All right, perfect. Let's check out the clip. We got the clip. Maybe.
Smooth up in ya.
All right, so that's just a little clip. Now, first of all, there's so many things I want to say. First of all, I love the hair. And I also love those pants.
Oh, thanks.
Where are those pants? You still have those pants?
Yeah, they're...
You have those pants still?
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, man, those are cool.
They're gonna, actually, we've been very, very blessed. I think those pants may be going into a big, giant glass case, which is going to be shown at the White House.
What?
Yeah, we've been asked to put some different memorabilia together through our very, very close friend, Mr. Senator Scott Brown.
Oh, wow.
Who has just received his ambassadorship to New Zealand. So we want to really tell Scott Brown, we love you.
Shout out.
All of our hearts. Big time love for you. And congratulations on your ambassadorship. We're so looking forward to going to New Zealand very, very soon.
That's awesome. Have you been before?
No, never have.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Oh.
It's really cool.
So we're stoked. So he invited us to, he's been such, we've been so blessed by meeting all these people, and we'll get more into it, but he's a huge fan of the band, and we were asked to basically donate some of the stuff, memorabilia, so they can hang it up somewhere in Washington, D.C. They're going to be doing this big thing for like a year and for the American rock artists. And we've been asked to do that. So that's like a real big thing for us. So we're like, wow, this is really rad.
That's so cool. So the pants are going to be in the White House.
Yes, hopefully. And actually, my guitar actually that did write a lot of those songs from back in the day. So we're going to be putting that up there too.
That's so cool and so exciting. And
man, totally.
That's so great. And okay, so back to the song, Smooth Up In Ya. That's a cool video, it's a cool clip, but what does that mean?
Many, many moons ago in galaxies far, far away, I played with an amazing musician. I was very blessed to be signed with Motown and be part of the Motown family when I was young. And a gentleman by the name of Al DeBarge, in his height of his career, asked me to come and play in his band, to be the guitarist in his band. I was really young, and it was one of my first tours ever. We were opening up for the great Ashford and Simpson. And Al was really, really big at that time. He hit with the movie and the soundtrack through Who's Johnny. So big tour, first bus and everything else. And Al was just such a lovely person, and has always been such a lovely brother to me and so loving. I learned a lot from him on the road, and one of them was his banter toward the women that he had on the tour of us.
Banter, that's like a really nice way of putting it.
Totally. He'd have these stories, and he's going to go, dude, you can't tell these stories. It's like, no, he used to tell the Kawasaki story, and then he'd have the dinner story, But he'd always tell the girls, you know, he'd have me sitting there in the hotel room because, you know, we were really close, and he'd have these beautiful models and stuff, and they were all really, really sweet. Nothing, it was very innocent, you know, it wasn't...
Sure.
No, for real. Like, I want to get that, you know, across. Back then, it was, Al was so classy and so loving to everybody. It wasn't that way, so he used to like to joke around. And one of the things he would tell some of the girls sometimes was like, God, you're so beautiful, girl. It's like, one of these days, you know, if you let, I want to go smooth up in you.
Wow.
Silk. And they go, oh, Al, you're so nasty. Why are you going to say that kind of stuff? You know, and he'd be like, no, that's love. That's love. Smooth up in you. And so, and we used to say this all the time on the road. And I told him one of these days, I go, you know, bro, I'm going to write a song that title. This stuff that we came up with out here. He goes, good luck getting that on the radio. And I was like,
boom.
And I said, that was a challenge. So sure enough, when the song became a hit and we were blessed with it, I remember walking into Warner Brothers, and Benny Medina was running the R&B label of Warner Brothers at the time. Benny Medina actually signed me to to Motown. Heartfelt friend, just person that showed me the ropes. I just love him to death. And I hear this guy playing piano, and these beautiful piano playing, and I'm going, God, I know that piano playing. And I walk in, and there's Al. And he has his back turned to me, so he's playing the piano, and I go, don't tell him I'm here, you know? And he turns around, and he literally comes up and loves him and tackles me on the foot. You did it, oh my God! I can't believe it, you did it! It's like, I told you I was gonna do it! He goes,
oh, man.
So that was the big thing. We used to say that all the time, so that was our little saying. And
that's funny. I mean, well, now that I'm thinking about, like, what, you gotta be a confident guy to say that to a girl, though, right? Like, man. I don't know many people who can pull that off.
I learned a lot of confidence because he was always so dapper and always so just beautiful. He'd always dress up, you know, he was always dressed so sharp and, you know, treated people amazingly. And, you know, we had Sugar Ray Leonard coming to shows and all these big, huge stars. And here I am, you know, this young guy, first tour, you know, people in the band that, you know, played with Chaka Khan and,
yeah,
you know, and he dragged me all this, you know, puts me in this situation, and it was not easy. You know, I'm a rock, punk rock guitar player, and I'm playing in this R&B thing, but I grew up with an R&B background, so, and I have an eclectic musical background, so actually that I was playing in the band, it really, really taught me a lot on how to think on the fly. Al was, I have to give him credit, he's an amazing artist and a brilliant, how would you say it, soundscaping. He would have to hook up all these keyboards back in the day when you would have to sequence keyboards together. He sequenced all these keyboards together and they would run the show. They would do the backgrounds with us singing and everything else. And real quick story, we were at the Radio City Music Hall and we were opening up for Ashford & Simpson. Place was packed, it sold out. And we go into the first song and everything's working, the tracks are going good. We're like, yeah. And then all of a sudden we go into the second song and, you know, we're doing good. And all of a sudden the tracks start malfunctioning.
Oh,
it's
no.
It's like, who's Johnny? Who's sometimes, who's holding on? And I mean, it's like, and all the stuff is coming out and the crowd's murmuring. It's all this stuff is going wrong. And he'd been waiting for this show forever.
Yeah.
So in the middle of the show, he turns around, looks at the band. He looks at me. He walks over to the keyboards, shuts off everything, looks at me, says everybody's fired tonight, walks across the stage and sits down at a grand piano that they had there. Starts playing the grand, going into this thing. And we don't know what he's gonna do. I mean, it's the scariest thing in the world. You're sitting there and we have this huge audience and you're going, what is he gonna do? So he starts playing, sometimes a love won't let go. And he turns around and looks at us and we all come in. Boo doo doo doo, four piece jazz style. And we finish the whole show like that.
Wow.
And the place went nuts.
Talk about a recovery.
Yeah, and it was just like, and I'll never forget, because I walked back and he wouldn't let anybody in the dressing room, and I walked back in there and he was just beside himself with just grief. And I just thought, you sounded amazing. What do you, you know, this was unbelievable that we pulled this stuff off. Ah, it shouldn't have been like this. And we should have, but I go, should have, would have, could have.
Yeah.
So it was, a lot of times, he showed me how to make things happen when things weren't happening. So that was learning from that and being signed with Motown and learning so much from Benny Medina and Kerry Ashby Gordy Jr., Barry Gordy, who I was this anomaly when I was signed with them, and they couldn't understand that this guy could sing like this, could sing this R&B stuff. So Motown, before I was signed with Warner Brothers, really, really taught me a lot. Just how to, you know, how to write and be sitting in writing sessions with these amazing writers. And
how old were you at that time?
Gosh, what, 16, 17, something like that. But you know, I still hold those memories very fond, and I'm very, very fortunate to be a part of the Motown family.
Yeah. You know? And you know, I heard you say, and you have an eclectic musical background, and basically since you were a little kid, right?
Since I was 6 or 7.
Tell me about that, because that's like, you know, that's crazy.
Well, I come from a very musical family. My mother and father were were musicians, and my father played with a couple big bands. My mother did background singers for a couple big people. And when I was really young, we had a guy that came into our family that wanted us to be like the new Partridge Family. So he would get our family together and we would go perform at colleges.
That's so cool.
Like Cal State LA and, you know, this college and that college, and like about 7 years old. And we had, the guy was his name was Wally Wozniak.
Oh, wow.
And his friend was a writer by the name of Skip Soder. Both of them have passed away, God bless them, rest in peace. But Skip Soder, the writer, took a really liking to me, and we started writing together. And he really taught me how to really write, because no one ever sat down. I never knew how to write a song, so that's how I really started learning, was by Skip. He taught me how to use my poetry, because I was writing poetry when I was very, very young, to use it and to channel it into music. So that's where I first started.
Very cool.
Yeah.
And you know, it's funny because, well, we're going to be playing a fun little game. So for all you guys watching at home, you guys are just tuning in right now. We're coming to you live from Music Studios Los Angeles. I'm here with Marq Torien from Bullet Boys. We're talking about everything. We're talking about a little bit of everything.
We're talking about it all.
And we're going to be doing a fun little game in a little bit where we're going to be doing singing impersonations. So that's coming up, and it's gonna be
by the way, Roxanne is just totally rad, and thank you so much for inviting us here.
Aww.
It's just so beautiful. Thank you.
Yeah, for sure. I'm excited to have you, but I want to touch on what you said, because you know, obviously you're a singer of Bullet Boys, frontman extraordinaire.
Yes.
But also such an amazing guitar player.
Oh, thank you.
Which, you know, I think maybe some people who might not know, but actually you were mentored by Eddie Van Halen.
Yes.
That's
and
crazy.
Other people. I was very fortunate to be hanging around cats when I was very, very young. Jeff Beck was another guy that people would bring me in, and he would be playing there, and I'd be watching, and you know, I'd constantly watch these guys play. And you know, when I was young, I got to hang around Van Halen and see a lot of the way they ran their business and ran their band, and it was very grandiose to me, and really. They were so loving that they let me in behind the scenes into their family. And
yeah.
I think it was only because we had a really great relationship. I met Van Halen, the first time I've ever met the guys was at a Troubadour show with my high school band. David and Alex were there at the show.
Yeah.
And
that just sounds like so
it was,
surreal. You
yeah,
know what I mean?
Here
because
we are.
That's like,
yeah, and they're
that's
sitting
crazy.
At the back bar, and my bass were playing the stuff, and they were hooting and hollering. They loved the band. And when we finished, the owner, manager came up and said, hey, you know, David and Alex are sitting back there. They'd like to meet you guys. And it's like, you got to be kidding me. So we go back there and say, hey, you guys, what's going on? My name's David. This is Alex. It's Alex's birthday today. We just want to tell you guys are from Montebello, right? It's like, yeah. He goes, you guys are kicking ass. It's a great band. We're just a 3-piece band. He goes, and you're a guitar playing. Oh, my God. You know, and then Alex's like, my brother needs to see you play guitar.
Whoa.
You're playing serious guitar. So we ended up staying there, drinking with them, underage.
We won't tell.
Till about 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning.
Wow.
And David was such the sweetest and kindest. And Alex, they were so sweet to these young guys. And I'll never forget that, because they took that time with us to let us know that they liked that. So I just started hanging out with David, and we just started, we developed this friendship, and he would holler at me, and, you know, we'd start palling around together, and just kind of, you know, I just kind of got brought into it, but I got to see so many things of the mighty, magical Van Halen that that will never be, I'll never experience that again, because it was just so outrageous, and Ed and his brother Alex and Michael, especially my brother Michael, they've always been so kind to me. And I get a little emotional talking about it, because in this business, you don't get that. You know, you don't get people that take that time when you're young to sit down with you and to really ingratiate your talent and to tell you, to motivate you to keep on going on. I mean, and that, to when you're young, that's a big thing, you know?
Life changer.
I mean, you're sitting at the Troubadour. I know that a lot of my friends would go, no, I was there, you know, you'd be sitting there and he'd go, amigo, come over here. And I could, you know, go through a sea of people just to hang out and sit down. What are we doing tonight, you know? But I just love David with all my heart. He's always been so kind to me and my family and the band, especially when we were with Warner Brothers. They passed a torch to us, which is a big thing for us. You know, we weren't worthy, and but we were, to me, like those Van Halen, but we were like the evil Van Halen. we were completely this fighting band that, you know, just liked to brawl and just, you know, get under people's skin, and we had a very punk rock attitude, so it was a little different. But they were very, and always have been very kind. Shout out to Ed, shout out especially to Alex. I love them with all my heart. David and Michael, of course, you guys know. And, you know, now we'll go into Sammy too. Sammy's a huge, huge supporter and always has been.
We'll call them by their first names. Us, you know, us people. I hate to call them by their full name.
No.
You're just so cool. Just
no.
You know, Sammy and
David. Oh, he's just awesome though. But it's like, it sounds so weird to say that, but it's like, you know, it's like these cats really, you know, were around to help me. I mean, we saw Sammy in Vegas, a couple years ago? And he was just so kind, man, and just so, it's just so loving. And, you know, he said these wonderful things about me, and I'm just like, get out of here.
We,
you know, in front of a room full of people, it's just like, wow, you know, that's really special, you know, that people think like that and that they have a lot of love for what I've done, you know?
Well, I think when people are maybe a loving kind of person, then they meet with other kind of loving
totally.
People.
See?
High five.
I like it.
That. I love it.
I like it.
All right, so let's take a break and get into this game. What do you think?
Sounds good to me.
All right, so here's how the game works. Basically, we are going to be, because I'm going to do it too, and obviously we have like Mr. Frontman Singer Amazing over here, and I'm not good. So, okay, I just want to preface this whole game with saying that I cannot sing, and I know that, so just know. So this is how it works. We literally just got these right before the show. We haven't practiced. We haven't rehearsed. This is just for you guys on Facebook Live, everyone watching. So basically we're going to get a celebrity famous singer, and we're going to have to sing a different song as that singer.
Gosh,
so
this is not going to be easy, guys, either.
It's not going to be easy, but we got the mic right here.
Okay.
Hooked up to the mic mechanic over here. All right, so let's see. This is the first one. All right, this is for you. This is Shake It Off by Taylor Swift, but you have to sing it as Axl Rose.
Oh, my gosh.
So Axl Rose voice singing Taylor Swift. You just got to give us a couple lines, you know? Just a little bit.
Okay, let's
see. Just a little ditty.
Let's see here. Okay.
I'm excited.
Okay, let's see. Here we go. I gotta get into character first, though. Hold on.
Get into your Taylor character.
Wait a minute. I almost had it. The name is gonna shake, 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 shake. Any name is gonna shake, 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 shake. Whoa, shake it all, shake it all.
Yay! So
I'm
good.
I'm not making fun either. I'm trying my best.
No, it's so good. Okay, it's like you just did that, and now I know that I have to go right now after you. And
yes.
I'm like,
Mikey.
Oh, okay, pass the mic. All right.
Yes.
Again, not a singer.
Yes. Okay.
At all. Okay. All right. That's Brittany.
Uh-oh.
I need a fan blowing my hair. I don't really have one, but
hold on.
Right,
let me get some.
So I'm gonna be singing Too Late to Apologize as Britney Spears.
Yay!
All right. I'm scared. I'm nervous.
Shh.
I'm nervous. Look who I'm sitting in front of.
Stop it.
What if David is watching? David, if you're he watching, this. Let's be friends. Okay,
yes.
Here we go. All right. It's too late to apologize. It's too late. That's it. That's all I got. Oh, man. That's tough.
Yeah, that was rad.
That was tough.
Yeah.
All right. I got the...
Yeah, you got...
That's what I got.
I like it.
That's my Britney. That's it for now. I did it. I'm proud of myself.
You are badass. Are you kidding me? That was really good.
Was it?
Yeah.
All right. Well, anyway. All right. Back to you. What the people want. Let's give the people what they want and talk about you. All right. So tell me, obviously we talked about the Bullet Boys back then, you know, so many great and awesome hits and so many great pants. I love all your pants. I was watching videos today and I was just like, I'm so jealous of all his pants.
Oh, you're so rad.
They're so cool. They're going to be in the White House. So there you go.
And we're going to be making some stuff. I'm working with our merchandise and creator of some of our stuff, Mr. Tony Sinacropi. And we've been talking about putting out a line of some of those pants and recreating
those. Oh, my God,
please.
Oh,
thank you.
You put me on this. I'll be on the waiting list to order the first pair.
Come on in.
I'm down.
We'll get you all styled up. But we're going to be doing something really cool with different fashion stuff. And I love Tony. Shout out to Tony. He's been there this past, 7 years, going on 8 years since we reinvented this band. And he's been such a loving soul. He just painted this beautiful painting of me playing guitar. And it just completely made me start tearing up, and we have it in our home. So,
oh wow,
Tony's just amazing.
That's awesome.
He believes in what we're doing, and shout out to Tony, right, baby?
Shout out, Tony. Yeah. Well, you know, it's funny because you just said that, which I didn't know that until just right now. But you have so much going on right now.
Oh my gosh,
you know,
yeah.
You're not obviously someone who is living in the past whatsoever. You have so much going on. You have so much, you know, moving forward. So tell me a little bit about the album.
Sure.
Your new album that you just finished yesterday.
Yay!
Yesterday, just finished yesterday. So tell me about that.
Just mastered all finished up. Well, first of all, I want to thank God for helping us achieve what we've been trying to achieve on this record. I want to thank my team of people that are behind us, Drew, Rodney, Alice, everybody at the label, Jeff Soto, Mario at Frontiers. I want to thank my agent, Chuck, over at Artists Worldwide, and everybody that's been so diligent in waiting for this process of this record. I worked very hard in the writing of this record, and I've been very, very blessed as of late to have these amazing angels that have come into my life. First want to start off with where we recorded the record at. We recorded the record at 606, which is the Foo Fighters home, which is the guy's studio, and we were invited in because of the music that we were writing, and I just want to send a shout out of love and thanks, many, many, many thanks, and big love to David Grohl and the band for, and Lou and Wiley, and everybody was there that that ingratiated us with being able to go in and cut our record there. 606 is probably the greatest studio that I've ever been in. It's very magical. It has aspects of being able to feel all those hits that were written by my favorite band in this place and recorded there. And when you go in there, you just feel this, I feel when I walked in there, I said, gosh, I'm really not worthy, you know, to be here. And I don't know why I'm here. And it's very humbling. But then, you know, David came in after the third day we were doing tracks, and I never met him. I know everybody else, but it's like, we never really, you know, he comes in the door and he goes, wait a minute, I know you. And I was like, I know you too, but I kind of don't know. And he goes, well, we know each other now. And
there you go.
He gave me a big hug and so much love. And he started telling me the story about something like, there's like 10 degrees of separation of the story, and it was just like really amazing. And then, you know, I was telling him thank you so much because for his music. I've been through a lot in my personal life as of late in the past 7 years, and I was put through something that was very difficult for, I think, any human being to deal with. And that was, I don't really want to get into it, but it was divorce. And the fact that I'm still here talking to you and being blessed and to have these people around me is like unbelievable, because I really didn't really want to be here after what I went through. So I was talking to David about it and telling him, you know, thank you for writing the stuff that you wrote. I mean, I listen to you every day, and it helped me fix my heart. And he goes, and he told me something that was really poignant. I'll never forget this. And he looked at me and he goes, do you know why I wrote those songs? And I was like, there could be any reason, right?
Yeah.
I said, no. He goes, so I could do the same thing.
Wow.
So it was that common thing of learning, you know, when we came out with the BULLETBOYS, you know, we were known as this, you know, the sex joint type of band, and, you know, we're writing all these bands, sexy bands, sex songs and stuff like that. And that was all good, but I always wanted to, not mature, but to be motivated to write different stuff, so write different material. So if you notice on the BULLETBOYS records, each record is different, but in congruency with the sound. So I've always tried to stay with that. So now with this record, you know, I'm taking, from what I understand from other people, big risks.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, then we'll take big risks, and that's what inevitably brought us into 606. So we recorded there, and then we're coming into the end of the session, and I am probably the biggest Eagles of Death Metal fan on the face of the planet. I am a fan. I mean, I love the band with all my heart.
So cool.
It's just, I've seen their first show, you know, when they first started the band 10, 13 years ago. And I've always loved Jesse Hughes. I've always loved his voice. I always loved what he stood for and what he does. And especially the fact of what they went through at the Bataclan in Paris. It's something that none of us as musicians have ever experienced or ever been put in that situation. And to me, he is my superhero.
Yeah.
And he saved people's lives, and he did things out of the box that most bands wouldn't do.
Like an actual real life superhero.
Like a
like a rock star superhero.
No, he is. Boots Electric is a superhero to me. He is. This whole band is. Mm-hmm. Jenny, Jorma, Davy Joe, Epi, all the people that are in the family of the band who has let me into their family because of, we were finishing final mixes, and my drummer Joaquin Revolta was very close with Epi, who is in the Eagles of Death Metal and works for the band. And he's going, listen, you know, I really want to talk to Jesse. Marq wants Jesse to come in. Can he come and sing on the record? And I've never really had anybody sing on any of our records. But there was this song called D-Evil, which is going to be our first single. And I just had this feeling of that if Jesse could sing on the song with me and we could do a collab, that would be just the raddest thing that anybody's tried to attempt by mixing the two genres.
Yeah.
And it hasn't really been done before. So Jesse was all about it, and he told Joaquin, oh my gosh, he's Marq Torien? He's like, yeah. He goes, oh my God, he's my favorite fucking singer. I love that dude.
What?
So I was like, and Joaquin's like, you gotta be kidding me. He goes, dude, I had a poster of these guys up above my bed. I mean, you have no fucking idea. I'm down with it. He goes, where does he need me? So like Joaquin calls me, goes, he's down with it. I was like, and then I started getting freaked out. So I'm like,
you guys are like fans of each other without even knowing it.
Yeah, totally. So like, you know, I just didn't know, oh my God, he's gonna cut. So let's get this thing done, and he's gonna come down. So he came down, and you know, and it's so magical because he's coming up the walkway and I'm in the backyard, and I think somebody came up and goes, Jesse's here. So I came up and we both saw each other. It was like a movie. He just dropped everything, I dropped everything, and we go to hug each other, and just our tears came out of our eyes. It was just like this feeling of that, you know, I was emotional because of what he went through and that he took the time to come and bless me with his wizardry was was amazing. And he wanted to be so part of it. And then, you know, we sat in the backyard and he opened up and he was sharing with us some really deep stuff. And he's like me. So there's this deep stuff and how would you say, emotional characters that we are that, you know, we wear our hearts on our sleeve, and that's what Boots was. And he came and made magic with the song. It was just like the voices together and everything came together. So ever since then, we've become extremely close friends. And he's like my bestie to me because he's the first guy that's ever been a champion of my band.
Wow,
and,
that's awesome.
There's a lot of guys that, you know, that have not really done that. Shamed my band and said a lot of things, you know. And all we do is we just want to write great music and be at a certain level. And for somebody to come in and take that time with me and to do that for me is like, you know, I'd give my house and my shirt off my back to somebody like that, because they're just family. So anything that he needs of me, whatever that is, he's got it, you know. Like, and then I got invited to come in, and they just got finished doing the soundtrack for Super Troopers 2, and Jesse asked me to come in and sing with him. So I was like, oh, you got to be kidding me. So they redid the Man's for Man song, Blinded by the Light. Man, wait till you guys hear this.
I can't wait.
It's fucking unreal. And so we did this thing, we worked on it, and I actually got to play some guitar on it too. So Davey asked me to play some guitar, and I've never been around more loving people in the business than this band. I've never experienced someone accepting me for who I am. I don't feel like I've ever been really accepted. I always feel like I'm like a misfit from the Island of the Misfit Toys. You know, I never fit in anywhere. You know, whether it was having to dye my hair blonde to make it, or to be in that club of those guys, I never felt like I was like in the mix. But with everybody that's coming now and the people that have been coming and being these angels to my band, I really feel like I've come full circle. Like, in, I feel like I'm accepted. And that's like a very heartfelt, loving thing for me, because when you're accepted like that musically and as an artist and respected as a writer like that, it you feel like you could just go to a mountain and go, mountain fall, the mountain's gonna fall, you know? And now I've been being taught and retaught, when we think we've given love, we have to give more love. When we think that we've reached our apex of loving on people, that's not it. We have to love more because of the fact where this world is right now.
Absolutely.
And us as artists, and that we are a little bit older, that, you know, I'm like, you can't teach a new dog new tricks. But they're not tricks, they're facts. And they're loving facts of how you react to when someone treats you with loving love and kindness and real love. It's really hard to go back and go, I can't do that. I'm going to be this untrustful person. I'm going to do this. And you can't do that after, you know. And
yeah.
And that's what that's what we're in right now. I don't want to be around people that that have a lot of negativity to talk about in their lives, when we should all be so grateful and thankful that we live in the United States and that we can play rock and roll music. I love rock and roll music. I love rock and roll with all my heart. I mean, I'm all about it. But I'm all about every kind of music, you know?
Yeah.
So the fact that we're able to do that and tour and play and to be involved with these amazing and great prolific musicians is just a blessing to me. I don't know how else to explain it. It's like that they took this time with this little band from so-called Cal, the BULLETBOYS, that people are like, oh, whatever, you know? And they took this time and said, no, we get you.
Yeah.
We know what you want to do, and we're going to help you facilitate that.
And it seems like just from what you've told me here, it kind of seems like you've not been lucky, because obviously it takes a certain kind of person to get other of the same type drawn to them. But it seems like, you know, the music industry, just like the entertainment industry, can be really cutthroat.
Oh, my
but
gosh.
But it seems like you've had the support even from a young age, when David Lee Roth came out and
yeah.
Eddie Van Halen to just support you. And now, you know, with even
yes.
the death metal. So I think that kind of shows that, you know, when you're a good person and you just want to support others, then other people are going to support you too.
You know, I agree with you wholeheartedly. But it's, even when those cats were like, who I love very dearly, I just got to say right now, if you're out there and if any of you see this, I just love Jesse Hughes with all my heart. And I want to thank him and the band for being my family and doing things for me and being these magical people that have come into my life and have doing these amazing things. I love you, Jesse. I love you, Ginny. I love you, Jorma. I love you, Dave. I love you, Eden. Eden came from Montebello, so I'm so proud of him.
Hometown.
Yeah, hometown boy. But yeah, these guys have really opened up my eyes to not to be have a journey. I'm gonna say a journey life. Open my eyes to a new kind of way. You know, it's
awesome.
Really, you know, every day I really try to do things by giving back by really giving back. And it's not the easiest thing to do when this is, it's such a, this business is such a me business.
Yeah.
You know, me, yeah. It's about me. You know, it's like, but when you turn it around and you don't make it about you and you make it about we and you make it about them and you make it about this person, or it changes, you know? Like, we just had this huge backyard party at our house for our very, very family friends, Phil X and his wife, Lindy. And Phil X plays for Bon Jovi. Shout out to Phil X. Where are you, Phil?
What's up, Phil?
Shout out to Lindy. But we threw this backyard party for us. And then, you know, we're going, okay, what? And X is like, we got a jam. And I was like, we're gonna do a backyard party? Okay. And I'm calling people, why don't we just get some plywood and shit and set it up in the back? And, and then our friend, Diego Negretti, who works for The Voice, who's an angel, comes and brings us a stage. Like a literal stage.
That's just what happens when you're Marq Torien, people just bring you stages and they just bring you like people, and it's just, it went from backyard parties to just epic event.
No, it wasn't. I'm sitting there and watching all these guys play in my backyard. I'm going, are you freaking kidding me? It was so rad. And then we got a chance, and then Jesse shows up with the band, and then he ended up DJing the whole night, and it's just
I need an invite to the next one, because that sounds amazing.
That's what everybody says, so it's all over. We had like close to 500,000 people watching this thing.
Whoa.
It was like insane. So now, I got this idea of, like, when I was talking to you, we want to do this like backyard series.
Yeah.
Like a backyard thing, and get like all these guys that we know that are in these big bands and saying, hey, let's get this thing and let's do pay-per-view and we'll do a backyard party. That's like, that sounds, I mean, so we're always trying
I'll order the pay-per-view, I'll watch it.
Yes.
You got one for sure.
So we're always trying to do something out of the box, and I think that's where we're not, the Bullet Boys is, we're always trying to do something out of the box. right now, we are kind of faded away. We're trying to stay out of the whole public eye thing because I've learned in the business, you know, you got to go away to come back.
There you go.
And when you come back, you better come back with fucking full guns blaring.
Strong.
Yeah. Make sure you got those six guns out, because if you don't have them, there's so many brilliant and beautiful and bands now that are writing these eclectic musics, and you know, all these bands of the now. You really have to be ready for coming out with
something. You got to bring your A-game.
Yeah. So we're very fortunate that we mastered and finished our record yesterday. It's taken a bit because the producer that we worked with actually wasn't very forthcoming to us and gave us something that we weren't very happy with. And for all intents and purposes, we went into it with a lot of love, and one of the guys that was there did not put a lot of love into this. And it really broke our hearts because we put so much into it and we believed in this person. That he gave us something that wasn't at top form. So we had to go and you know, do some recon, and our friend Brent came in and helped us with this record and mastered it to its fullest potential. He's worked with Michael Jackson, Boys to Men, the list goes on, Stevie Wonder. I mean, he's just an amazing guy. And for him to come in and say, this record is so prolific, I'm not worried about you paying me. I want to help you with this.
Wow, that's a big deal.
So, yeah, I mean,
yeah.
So it's just like, so, I mean, God's really blessing us. I mean, you know, for real, because, like, this kind of stuff only happens in the movies, you know, like.
Or in your real life.
man, I'm telling you, it's just, like, unreal.
This sounds like a movie. I'm, like, sitting here listening to this.
Right?
And it's like, all right, so he's hanging out with, like, David Lee Roth and Eddie Van Halen, and now Eagles of Death Metal are playing in his backyard.
Recently, I gotta be real honest, I have not spoken to Ed and David in a very long time. But I saw Michael actually a couple years ago at a award show for him, and I actually got up and we did some Van Halen songs together.
Oh, that's cool.
So it's like, why weren't we doing this before?
Well, speaking of songs, are you ready for another one?
Oh, here we go.
All right, here we go.
Yeah.
Let's see, what do we got? So this is you now. Boom. We got Like a Virgin.
By my boy.
Steven
Piercy. See?
All right.
Okay.
Here, take the mic.
Here we go.
Are you ready?
Yeah, I think I'm so.
You okay? I'm ready for you. I'm not ready.
See, I got to get my rat on, though. This guy,
like,
you know.
In, like, take a minute. Like,
that's my boy. I get it together. Okay, let's see.
Like a Virgin.
Like a Virgin.
stuck for the very first time, like a virgin. Yeah!
That was awesome. That was so good. That was so good. All right.
So you have to get the clench.
I know, you gotta get the like the
some other day, some other way.
You can't actually open your mouth at all.
No,
your teeth clench the whole time.
He's such a badass. Like, I love him to death.
No, he's saying everything like this.
And then you gotta go.
Then when you do your thing, another day, another way. Come on.
That's what he does. I got him down, trust me. I love him.
Oh man, you're awesome, and you're making me like real nervous about mine. All right. And like I said, you guys, if you're just tuning in, we're coming to you live from Music Studios, Los Angeles. We got Marq Torien from the BULLETBOYS, singer extraordinaire doing impersonations, and then we have Roxanne Avalon.
Killing it!
No singing game, so.
No.
It's cool. Like, it's just, you know, some people can sing and some people can't. And
she can
awesome.
Sing, you guys. It's for real. She can sing. I'm standing right here.
You're going to say that, and then people in the comments are going to be like, Mark's a liar.
Bullshit, let's go in the studio. Let's do it.
All right,
I'm ready.
Let's do it. Okay, so I got Baby by Justin Bieber as Louis Armstrong. All right. All right. Okay. I have to like. All right. You're like you're excited.
I love it. It's
I know. Like pressure's on because I don't want to let you down. Okay.
Oh my gosh.
All right. Okay. Don't make me laugh.
That's really good.
Okay. Baby, baby, baby. Oh, like, baby, 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 oh.
Fuck yeah, that's awesome. Yeah.
All right, that's as good as I could get for that.
That was really good.
Was that good? All right, maybe I'll start like a cover band, you know?
Well, hello, darling.
I just do the whole rest of the interview.
It's so nice to have you back where you belong.
God, I love him, dude. Sashmo, come on now.
Okay, so your new album, just finished it yesterday. When can all of us normal folk get grace our ears with this album?
We are going to be releasing this next year.
Okay.
There's a lot of stuff that's out there right now that's out. A lot of new albums are coming out, and we just really want to have the time to do the right footwork and road work to get this record going. And another shout out I have to throw out. I just want to throw out a shout out to KLOS.
Throw it out.
KLOS and everybody at KLOS. I want to thank them for stepping up on our last record, Elefante, and playing the crap out of Rollover. I just love you guys so much, KLOS. Thank you for supporting our band. Thank you for championing that record. And I can't wait for you to hear the new one. So.
And then you're going to be following that with the tour, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yes. Give the people what they want.
Yes.
So you're a world tour, right?
Yes. We're doing some eclectic dates right now, just trying to, you know, get out there, just doing what we do. But we're planning on kicking this thing off in February, and the record's called From Out of the Skies. So I think we don't know exactly what the tour is going to be called, but we're working on a real big package with another band, and I don't want to get into it right now, but it's going to be really stupid special.
We're excited.
And
the suspense.
Yeah.
You're just building so much suspense.
We're just really excited because, you know, we want to really play with some bands out of our supposed genre. Sometimes I don't really feel like I'm really accepted in my genre. By other bands. I don't know what it is, but it's kind of like we're this.
I was saying,
we're like the dogs behind the fence, these wild dogs behind the fence. You know, that's what this guy once said. He goes, you guys are ferocious. Like, you guys aren't, like, it's this other thing. So, it's to reinvent a band like ours and to go in and try to do something like that when everybody always has this thing of, this is the way it was, well, why isn't it that way? At some point in your career, you always have to reinvent yourself. And the past 7 years, myself, C-Mac, and Nico have been reinventing this band and been working very hard. We play shit clubs, we play big festivals. It doesn't matter to us. It's as long as we're there and we're playing our music and people are there. But we worked very hard on reinventing the band. And now the band has been embraced as we are now and has been told that we're a way better band than what we were, that from people that saw us live. And now granted, back in the day when we were doing this stuff, way back, we were pretty fucked up. I mean, we were partying a lot. I mean, it was
who wasn't?
chemical refreshments were pouring out everywhere. Alcohol, you name it, it was there. But I never got into the business to get jacked up on drugs. I wanted to get in the business to write stuff, write great music. So now that we're here, it's like, okay, well, I guess we kind of got to accept you the way what you're doing, because you're doing something way out of the box that we're not doing. So
yeah,
everybody's coming in, some of my friends that are from that genre, and coming in and being really supportive. Like the other day, I was talking to a really amazing, famous drummer who's a really good friend of mine, and he goes, did you just play those two songs out of the PA? He goes, is that your new record? It's like, yeah. He goes, oh my God, are you fucking kidding me? Dude, it's like, wow, it sounds incredible. He goes, it's a whole new band. I said, yeah. You gotta put out stuff that's gonna,
yeah,
it's gonna catch somebody's ear, or it's gonna catch someone's heart, and just like, you know, it can't be this, you know, the stuff that was back in the day.
Yeah, you gotta keep evolving. and that's you know, that's another thing too that I wanted to ask you, because obviously, like, you are back in the day and you're still doing it now, but your sound is evolving. But what do you think about how rock and roll was back then compared to how it is now? Like, obviously it's changed.
I would say that the spirit has not died with a lot of the young bands that I hang out with. The spirit is still there, even though it is different with labels and everything else. But the spirit of hard work is there, and the spirit of wanting to achieve great things and to not to necessarily just be famous, but to be accepted into the whole world of rock and roll and musicians. And I look at a lot of these bands, some of my favorite bands right now, Rival Sons from Long Beach, you know, they're from here, Cali. Really amazing band, walking by their own beat of their own drum. One band that actually, punk rock band that I actually think is, who I just love their tenacity and love their hard work, and I've gone to see a couple times, and I'm a very strong supporter of Barbed Wire Dolls. I think they're just great. My girl, who's the lead singer, and her husband, who are in the band, they're out doing a European tour right now, and they're on the Vans Warped Tour. Shout out to Barbed Wire Dolls. You guys are working your fucking asses off out there. I see you. And they're just badasses. So there's some bands coming out of LA that are just really bad. I mean, I could just keep on going on with some bands, but it's like, you know, you just look at stuff like that and they're going, okay, you're not listening to what everybody's telling you. You're just doing, this is the punk rock mentality. Don't listen to people, just listen to your heart,
mm-hmm,
and go out and do this. Don't worry about, oh, there's no this and there's no labels and, you know, should we get signed or should we not get signed? All these questions, if you just stay true to your music and stay true to you, I think that's the big thing. When you start trying to make everybody else happy, you get lost, because then what you're trying to do is, it's not
absolutely there. And I think that obviously shows, because clearly you, since before you said you kind of didn't really fit in, because you were kind of just, you wanted to do your own thing, but that's why you're still going. You have so much, you know, I feel like so much going on and such a long future ahead, and that's probably because you do stay true to yourself.
I've had people that have been very, very disrespectful to me, and you know, I've been doing this since I was 7, probably a lot longer than a lot of my contemporaries in my genre, and there's some cats that really don't like me, you know, and for whatever that reason is, I don't think I've never gone out of my way purposely to hurt anybody.
I got your back, I'll just fight them.
Fuck people, yeah!
I'm gonna fight them.
No, totally, no.
You don't like my boy Marq Torien?
No, stop it.
Come over.
And I understand, you know, I get people don't get me, and sometimes, oh, F that dude, you know, whatever with that guy. But it's, you know, we just keep on ticking, and I don't care who really likes me or doesn't like me, because the people that don't like me don't really know me.
Yeah.
So they don't know my heart and inside and my family and, you know, how I live my daily life. And, you know, it's not about that. It's about trying to make yourself happy and make sure that your immediate family is taken care of before any of these people that are trying to throw sticks and stones at you all the time. And, you know, social media is very harsh sometimes.
Yeah,
you know,
it's tough now, but everything, you know, is so open. Everyone can, you know, it's like such direct, you know, contact, where
right,
before people just talk behind your back, but now they're posting it on your wall and you can see it.
Yeah, and it's really trippy, because, you know, to me sometimes, I don't think I shouldn't say this, I don't mean to mean this as a put down, but the normal person that's not in this business, like you're in this business, like I'm in this business, they don't understand that the downfalls and the pitfalls and maybe some of the things that have hurt your heart in the past, or people that have hurt you by doing things that they've done, saying things about you, or, you know, I'm a dark-skinned man, and I've had a lot of bigotry and racism in my life. I felt that I had to really dye my hair blonde at one point in my career because I wasn't accepted, and it was a different time back then. I've gone back to my natural, as you can see.
I love it, which I love.
Thank you. But there was that back then, you know, and for anybody that says that it wasn't, there was. And that I was able to make it out of Montebello, having Latino heritage and being a, I call myself a mutt. But to be that and to make it back in that time was almost unheard of, you know? So that the fact that we did it, and no, everybody thought I just had a really great tan.
Yeah. There you go. You just got to play it off. I was at the beach.
Oh, you know? We played it off so hard. And it's just at one point you start not really liking yourself because you're saying, well, I'm not being real with who I am.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that's what, after when you're not true to your heart and who you are, I think that's where the play of, you know, these magical drugs and alcohol just came in and go, oh, we can help you out. We will do this for you. And they make you feel that, you know, and then all of a sudden that's really cool. And then all of a sudden you feel like you want to kill yourself. And it's not cool anymore.
Yeah.
So you got to find another thing and say, you know what? I don't need this. I need to get rid of this. So, and figure that out. I've been sober for over almost 30 years.
Yay!
You know, and it's sobriety's really helped me be a much more understanding and loving person. I make mistakes every single day. My girl can tell you, she's sitting right here. She's one of the only person that
I just see her going.
Said screaming out at me and get in my face. And, you know, we're like punk rock love. It's like, you know, Sid and Nancy without the drugs. But, but you know, it's like, I listen to her, you know. Yeah. And there's not too many people that I really listen to. The fact that I'm still in this business, Roxanne, and still doing what we're doing, and that we're drawing people to where.
Still doing it well.
Oh, thank you. Trying to do it well, you know. Killing. There's so many great people out there. I'm trying my best, you know, but that we're still, you know, in the game. And I never thought I would be in the game still at my age and as long as the band's been around. And, you know, it's like, for once, Roxanne, people are giving us a time of day.
Yeah.
And we've never got that. It's always been, you know, a Poison or Warrant or, you know, or this band or Tom Kiefer or the, it's like, oh my God, it's like, and we were just like, oh yeah, the BULLETBOYS, oh yeah, there's that little dressing room over there, and you guys, oh, we don't have your rider, but we have a pizza and some water for you guys. It's like, and we're like, okay, you know, and people are like, ah, look at that. And we come up on stage and we take people out, because that's what we do. We're a ferocious band. We do not have, we'll play with anybody. We don't give a fuck. And I don't care. We'll get up there and we'll fucking, you know, and don't care if you're fucking, it doesn't matter what band you are. I will get up and play with any band, anytime, any fucking where. I don't care if we lose, but I'm going to get up there. I'm going to make sure that we put on a performance that people haven't seen in a long time.
I love that.
We're a plug and play. We don't have any background tracks, nothing. We're very punk rock. You know, real simple. We don't have this big, huge stage set up. You know, we have our band name. We get in there, but we play very loud and very proud. And that's the one thing with us that you'll get. I'm really singing. There's not anybody singing in the back curtain or, you know, thank God, you know?
I feel like you probably could have said a more rock and roll statement than what you just said. Just like, you play loud, you play loud, you just don't care.
Don't give a
fuck. Get up there and you're going to do you.
And people all the time, well, you know, you want to do this and, you know, be really cool around these people and stuff. And it's like, dude, if they can't accept me for what I am, then why, you know, this is rock and roll. It's rock and roll is full of mistakes. You know, I hear some people's records these days and everything's so perfect. It's like perfect and quantized and, you know, all this stuff. That's not rock and roll to me. Rock and roll is the Rolling Stones. Rock and roll is Iggy Pop. Rock and roll is, you know, like, the real deal, the mistakes. You know, like, if you don't have that in the record, it's not Bowie. You know, if you listen to all these records, I love the 70s and 60s music. It's my favorite music, some punk rock and strange 70s music, Lynyrd Skynyrd music. But if you listen to that stuff, it's the songs that have the weird, tiny little mistakes that you hear in the recording, and those are the things you want to hear.
It kind of makes it special.
Yeah. Absolutely, the imperfections.
It makes it special because it makes me feel like that's really them.
I wish more artists would do that now.
I make mistakes all the time, so don't worry.
I'm telling you, but it's so much more rad because, you know, those are the records, like, when I go back and listen to the records that I like, is that those little things, that the little crack in the voice or the guitar, like on some of the Stones albums, that's just a little bit out of tune that makes that really harmonized. It's just these little things, and people don't do it like that anymore. On this record, we try to do that.
Yeah.
So like when we were doing, I go, no, don't take that out of there. Well, it's kind of weird. I like it, leave it there.
Yeah.
Well, the voice is kind of doing, leave it.
Yeah.
It's real.
Exactly.
You know, don't make it so perfect. Rock and roll's not perfect.
Oh, you know? I love it. And I can't wait to hear the album.
Perfect.
It's so exciting. Can't wait to hear it. All right, so are you ready for the last impersonation?
We got Roxanne, one more. Anything you want, I'm
Whoa.
Here, honey.
Whoa, that's a bold statement.
You
better watch out. You better watch out. All right.
Hoo-ha!
All right, here, this is you.
Oh, boom. Man.
It's your boy Vince Neil singing I Will Always Love You by Whitney Houston. That's a tough one. That's a tall order.
I think I can do this.
You can handle it.
I can do this.
I know you can.
Especially
by the way, look at Vince Neil.
He looks so rad right there.
Vince Neil. I'm a big
me
fan.
Me too. Me too.
I just want to put that
I
out there.
I love Vince with all
I'm
my heart.
I'm a big Motley Crue fan, and I'm a big that right there.
Yep.
He looks so good. He looks so cool.
One of the first Chicanos in the fucking rock and roll business too, by the way.
He's so cool. Look at his blonde. He's just like trying to seduce me with his eyes. Stop looking at me, Vince Neil.
I could tell you
stop looking at me.
Some stupid cool stories about that badass right there.
Really?
Oh, he's the badass.
Can you tell me one really quick right now?
I
want to hear a crazy story.
No, I can't.
Oh my gosh. You have something crazy.
No. I can't.
All right.
Off camera.
Next time.
Okay. All right. It's not bad.
Well,
it's
just now everyone's wondering.
It's kind of like when we first met, you know, it's like.
All right. Well, when he tells me, I'll post it later so you guys can find out. All right.
Are you kidding? Tommy, Nikki, fucking Vince.
All right, ready? Here you go. I Will Always Love You, Vince Neil.
Okay.
Here you go. Ready?
I gotta get into Vince mode.
Channel the crew.
See, I will always love you. Oh, oh, I'll always love you.
Woo! That was so good. Yeah, I mean, he's got that, like, that high, like.
Yeah, he's got that real.
Almost like a little, like helium, but not really, like, yeah. That. I love that voice. That you killed it. Yeah,
he's nailed it. He's got that shit down. Let me tell you something. He's kicking ass live still there.
He is. Woo. I know. I seen him before, and I was like, he's still got it.
No, we did the Monsters of Rock Cruise,
mm-hmm.
And we were invited to do it. Which we were really happy about getting invited because we haven't been ever invited. And we were invited last year, so we're getting kicked ass. But we saw Vince, I was going, man, this guy's still throwing down. What the hell's going on?
Yeah. Totally. Totally. Yeah. Vince Neil, if you're watching, what's up? Just kidding.
Fuck yeah.
All right.
Big V.
All right, this is me. I'm going, Oops, I Did It Again by Britney
Iggy?
Spears. I'm doing it like Iggy Azalea, rapping.
Gotta get the booty.
I gotta
out.
Like.
Yeah.
Let me get my twerk. No, I don't have a booty like that. Okay. All right. All right. Are you ready? I'm gonna try.
Okay.
Don't laugh at me.
No, never laugh.
Just wait till after.
Always encouragement.
All right. Oops, I did it again. I played with your heart. I got lost in the game.
Oh. Stop. Oh shit.
Mic drop. Just kidding. I won't drop.
Big time.
Was that good?
That was awesome. Yeah.
I should have worn my shades. Look.
I like it. Yes.
Right.
Absolutely.
So, Marq, you're so cool. I'm so happy you came in today.
Oh, thank you.
Very
so
cool.
Much.
Bullet Boys. Make sure you guys
Thanks
follow
for
him.
Having me.
Follow him at Bullet Boys. They got an amazing new album coming out. You're gonna love it. We're just waiting. The anticipation is building. Got an album, the tour.
Got a video coming up.
Video.
Too. Boots Electric will be directing our video.
There you go.
And there's gonna be a lot of surprises in this video for everybody. We may be dressing up. In some way that you haven't seen us before.
Ooh.
And we could look mighty fine, too.
Uh-oh.
Woo-hoo.
You're just throwing these teasers out here. You're killing us. All right, you guys. So keep an eye out. Make sure you follow him at Bullet Boys. Keep an eye out for the album, the video, the tour, everything.
Support Roxy right here, Roxanne.
Support me.
On this beautiful, beautiful show, Music Rocks. This is probably the best time I've had in such a long time, man, you guys. It's really rad. Thank
you. Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Marq, for joining us.
And all the staff. Yes. You guys have been so badass.
Shout out to you guys.
Yes.
And everyone watching on Facebook, thank you so much for joining us on another episode of Music Rocks. Make sure you tune in next week on Behringer's Facebook page. And we'll see you next time.
Keep on rocking. Peace.
Bye.